A very warm welcome to all. My name is Roland Steinmetz, and I'm going to be your instructor for this section on advanced electric vehicle business. A brief personal introduction. I am founder of EV Consult. This is an international consultancy firm based in Amsterdam with the aim to accelerate the transition towards 100% zero emission mobility. We have a fast-growing team of experts with various backgrounds that specialized in strategy consulting and project management for a wide range of clients. Now back to the content. So far in this business track, we have learned about business strategies that can facilitate the transition to an electricity-based transportation fleet, as well as businesses' strategies to provide affordable charging to users. In this section, we will discuss some advanced businesses related to electric vehicles. Without further ado, let me get started with EV businesses based on autonomous electric vehicles, or AEV, as we like to call them. Governments today are broadly faced with two main challenges when it comes to mobility. Consider this. 200 years ago, there were less than 1 billion humans on planet Earth. Today, the world population is over 7 billion and is expected to grow. Growth in population is accompanied by rapid urbanization as more people move to cities in search of economic opportunities. And more people in cities mean more demand for mobility. If we continue as usual, private car ownership with internal combustion vehicles, our cities will run out of space and soon become very congested. Further adding fuel to the fire is the problem of climate change and air pollution in cities, to which internal combustion engine vehicles are major contributors. So what can be a solution to these twin challenges in mobility? Firstly, private vehicle ownership will be discouraged by governments. Autonomous vehicles, which can be shared more easily and can be parked more freely, will help reduce congestion in our cities. Secondly, electric vehicles fueled by sustainable energy sources, which are clean and more efficient than IC engine vehicles, can help mitigate air pollution and greenhouse gas emissions. Combine these two, and we find that autonomous electric vehicles can be an important part of the solution. How would a future with large-scale automation look like? Well, we can't say for sure, but here are four possible manifestations with varying levels of automation and car sharing. The x-axis tells how far is the technology automated, and the y-axis how much it is shared. Imagine autonomous driving on highways where the driver can intervene when he wants. The driver is all alone, so no sharing. This is the case of limited automation, limited sharing. The image in the left bottom half. Now look at the image on the right bottom half. The driver is fully relaxed, all by himself. So complete automation, but still no sharing. A good example of this is a car that is currently on the market and is equipped with automatic lane detection, automatic parking, and so on. Now coming to the top half. On the left we have limited automation with advanced sharing. An example of this is shared driving on highways. Think of ride sharing or public transport, where a high level of automation is not required. And finally, imagine autonomous driving everywhere in the form of shuttles with pickup and drop-off services. Here sharing is ubiquitous and every vehicle is a shared one. This is shown in the top right corner. This is the holy grail for a business case. Just imagine the utilization of this vehicle. Instead of 22 hours parked like a normal car, this vehicle drives the whole day. Continuing from the previous slide, it is important to understand that no one of the four scenarios will be in place everywhere at the same time. In fact, research shows these scenarios are highly location dependent. Driving on highways is not so difficult. Lower level of automation, such as cruise control and automatic lane control, will be enough. So we expect this to be implemented first, from now or 2020 onwards. Driving in cities is very complicated, as we all know. Imagine trying to cross a busy street in your city with 100 pedestrians passing by. The autonomous EV will never take off. So this scenario will take many more years to realize. The situation for suburban and rural areas is somewhere in between. While it is more complex than driving on highways, but we have more space and lower population density. So it is easier to implement than in cities. But there are still many times interaction between the road and the users. So not all the scenarios look so positive. Should we be disappointed? Not really, considering that approximately 30% of all road kilometers are driven on highways. Now, as we've learned, the adoption of EVs is expected to differ between locations. So what will be the impact of autonomous EVs on transport and spatial planning in these different locations? Autonomous highways with level 5 AEVs are first expected. This could result in the acceptance of longer travel distances and even of traffic jams. Therefore, this might cause demographic changes, with people living further away from their work. In cities, a further reduction of car ownership is foreseen. This is expected to cause a shift towards automated mass transport, AE buses and AE pods, cycling, increasing on electric bike, and walking. To make AEV possible, infrastructure adaptations are needed. Most experts at least foresee a more car-free zones in cities and hubs for park and ride, especially to facilitate automated mass transport services. Now coming to the suburban and rural areas, we expect private car ownership to prevail for at least a while. People will have their own AEV or will use automated mass mobility services as a form of public transport. The latter will put traditional public transport under pressure in these areas, especially because of the associated costs. Visually, a future with AEVs would perhaps look like this. Because it is in Dutch, I do not want to go into too much detail. What I want you to see is the autonomous highway on top, with AEVs platooning behind each other. Then in the middle, you see a car-free city center in green, with hubs around the city for parking and transfers in blue. To automated mass transport and other public transport services into the city. You can also see the additional functionality associated with AEV, for instance, as a small workspace or cinema. In the lowest part of the picture, we show the vision for use of AEVs for public transport services in rural areas. Finally, how will the charging infrastructure adapt to the location-dependent manifestation of AEVs? Along the highways, there will be ultra-fast charging stations to extend the range of AEVs, but most charging will be done at the destination when being parked. In futuristic city with AEVs, there will be parking hubs with AEVs will charge wireless, either AC with smart charging or DC to be on the run immediately without smart charging. As for rural areas, people with an AEV will charge their vehicle at the home and can use this as part of a smart energy system, being largely self-sufficient at household or neighborhood level. Indeed, the message should be clear by now. How people will use the AEV has a big impact on the business models. Now that we've looked at the different manifestations of AEVs, we can look at a few business models that can facilitate towards mobility with AEVs. In the earlier slides, we talked about the possibility of automated mass transportation systems in cities and suburban areas. We call it Mobility as a Service, or MaaS. This would take the form of an AE buses and single-person AE pods. To cater the different economic and social segments of the populations, users can choose on the basis of time taken to travel, reliability, that is a guarantee of no time delays, and different onboard services like internet, food, and comfort levels like first class or second class travel. For charging, we envisage centralized charging depots where you park your car and the vehicle is automatically charged. These charging depots may function based on wireless charging and will be optimized to match electricity supply with demand and manage the peak loads. Users will have a choice between two basic types of charging: faster but more expensive DC charging and cheaper but slower AC smart charging. So, as mentioned earlier, the AEV is no universal proposition. At different places and times, it will manifest itself in different forms. To conclude this lecture, we must ask what is to be expected from AEVs in the short term, say the next 10 years, and in the long term, say the next 50 years. The answer is that in the short term, we expect AEVs to become increasingly visible on highways. Charging will largely be limited to homes and offices, while limited growth in charging facilities along the highways can be expected. In urban areas, small pilot projects may be run to study the feasibility of AEVs to further improve the technology and remove bottlenecks. In rural areas, public transport by MaaS may take off in the form of autonomous electric buses. Looking at the long-term prospects of AEV, we expect radical changes. The way we think about cars itself might change. Large-scale private ownership, on-street parking and charging will disappear. This will be replaced by the concept of hubs for park and ride. So vehicle ownership could be shared, or private companies will provide you with vehicles to use and charge you per your usage. In terms of charging technology, wireless charging will become common. As vehicle utilization patterns develop, just as we have set patterns for electricity usage, smart charging will become increasingly feasible. Users will have a variety of mobility options to choose from: AE Segways, AE Pods, AE Buses, etc. And we expect to see a hybridization of private and public transport. Vehicles can be both private or shared. Thank you very much.